Welcome back, ZeroK fans, to the final round of the Swiss portion of the June 2016 1v1 tournament. On Nanalea Zidane, I remain your host, ChatTheFury333, and I am going to be casting, for the last match, Snugglebase and Google Frog, who are currently the top of the standings. I'll just update that to make sure. Yeah. Actually, Aquanim is at the top with 4 wins. Snugglebase and Google Frog are near the top, but it looks like it's Aquanim and Orphelius. Yeah, Aquanim and Orphelius and Snugglebase and Google Frog. Oh, actually, you know what? I've casted both Snugglebase and Google Frog separately. I'm going to do Aquanim and Orphelius. Actually, I changed my mind. We haven't seen much of either, and I feel like this is going to be... I feel like both of these are going to be really good matches, both Snugglebase, Google Frog, and Aquanim Orphelius. But it said go with, like I said, it's a top two, and actually it's 1 versus 3 and 2 versus 4, so it's a little harder to do that. But yeah, I'm going to go with Aquanim versus Orphelius. And that will be probably it before the bracket stage. So, this bit of a longer thing, took a bit of organization getting this thing going, but it's gone. I mean, it's worked out okay, actually. Pretty good turnout. We had 15 people, a couple of them dropped out, but overall, I think it worked out. And now moving on to the last round. Who was a buy in the last round, anyway? I think it's Ultimate Firestar, actually. No, Ultimate Firestar... No, they don't have a buy. Not sure who has a buy. I'm actually really curious now. King Raptor in theory, but I don't see that... Nope, they're still in. So yeah, not sure who has a buy this time around. Oh, it's Dianfriend. Okay, Dianfriend got the last buy. Doesn't really matter. I mean, I don't know, maybe lower rankings is kind of hard to get motivated at this point. But I'm curious how this is going to go. Like, I want to see... I want to see one of the top matches, and now there's a bunch of arguments going on about how Challenge actually deals with this stuff. I don't know, I didn't write the thing. But at any rate, yeah, Aquanim and Orphelius. Just get in my room and we can play. Oh, right, because I guess, yeah, because Orphelius had played Snugglebase in round 3, and that's why they can't play right now. Even though Snugglebase and Orphelius are closer in their ranking. Same as Snugglebase and Aquanim. So, once they actually get going, once reality has been accepted and they join the room, we will start the game. Not sure when that's going to be. There we go. Okay, Orphelius is in, and Aquanim should be following soon after. And that will be it. So, once they get into playing mode. I'm really curious how this is going to go. I mean, it's been a lot of small maps in this Swiss bracket, and I mean, I guess that kind of makes sense to keep the game times kind of short, although admittedly, there is a rule that works really well, so, or I don't know, really well, but it does sort of work. I mean, time-based draws make more sense for Swiss than they do for elimination, is what I'm trying to say. But what I don't understand is... What is the motivation of having all of this stuff here? And Orphelius needs a bit of a break. Makes sense. They're probably really tired. And it sounds like they're really tired. They did just play Markeeves and win. I mean, they've actually won every match but the one against Snugglebase. But yeah, both Aquanim and Orphelius are a little bit tired. We are going to have a break between the Swiss round and the bracket stage. or Swiss stage and practice stage, because people need a bit of time to recuperate and regroup. And I believe Orphilius and Marquise was 25 minutes long or something. Like, just about at time. Which, on a small map like Iced Coffee, is really... It's very grueling. Larger maps, it's also kind of grueling, but you kind of expect that. You go in there expecting it's going to take 20, 30 minutes. On a small map like Iced Coffee, you kind of expect it'll take 5, and then half an hour later it hasn't ended yet, and you're just thinking, oh, come on, what am I supposed to do? How do I get through this? And it's really annoying. So I can imagine that would be that would have flustered both players, honestly, because Aquanim was also against Snugglebase for almost 30 minutes. So both of these players... And apparently it was that Orphilius started as Jump Jets against Marquis Amphibs, then switched to the other factor, so he had Amphib Jump Jet for both sides, and then there was a base race. While Aquanim had Amphib Gunship against Shield Gunship Amphib. So, really, it was everyone playing the same factories in both cases. And trying to grind their way through. I mean, Amphib on Iced Coffee is super powerful because you can put them in more spots in the map. Whereas any other factory can be powerful, but it's a bit harder to make work. And I can see why people also went Jump Jets, because you can jump around and bypass some of the lakes. And it sounds like Aquanim managed to win despite a metal disadvantage, and Orphilius has been winning without really making any clever strategies, so this will be interesting. Because Aquanim is apparently being clever, and Orphilius is being brute force. And in Living Lands, there's a fair amount of room to actually get around, so... Man, I want to see what happens there. I'm really curious how this is going to go, because on the one hand, Orphilius might just punch through, and the sides won't matter. On the other hand, if Aquanim gets a good enough position, I'm guessing they'll probably use the flanks to great advantage. Although I think if... Oh yeah, actually, Orphilius does have to win this. If North Chilean G wins their match, and Google Frog wins their match, and Orphilius loses this match, Orphilius is not going to the next round. So Orphilius actually does have to win this to move on. Alright, Aquanim is currently ready. Orphilius are waiting on them. I'm actually really quite intrigued as to how they won their games, so I'm glad they shared. I'm really glad we know now how Orphilius and Aquanim both won their respective previous games, and... Once that gets going... There we go. Let us begin on Living Lands. Aquanim versus Orphilius. Round 5 of the Swiss. I apologize that the last one had round 3 on the bottom, not round 4. That was a mistake on my part. I don't know why I'm having a hard time with the Swiss stuff. With the bracket stuff, I've practiced my way away from having problems. Swiss, for some reason, I'm still having an issue remembering to update the bottom of it. Not sure why. Anyway, we are on to Living Lands, which is one of the maps I really like. I'm so glad it kind of took over from Deadlands. Granted, it's not much different. There isn't this metal extractor hill. This hill is just a hill, but it's also much prettier. Orphilius going for Cloaky Bot Factory. Aquanim going for Shield Bot Factory. No light vehicles, no air play either. Just Cloaky versus Shield Bot. Very standard. Very straightforward. I'm a bit surprised Orphilius is the one going for Cloaky when they just mentioned they've been brute forcing their way through their matches. Aquanim, on the other hand, same thing. Why? I mean, shields. Okay, shields you can be clever with. But at the same time, it's like I would almost expect, given the way they've apparently been playing, Aquanim would go for Cloaky and Orphilius would go for shields, but we're seeing the opposite. So let's see what Orphilius does as far as brute force, if they are going to go for brute force or if they're going to try to be clever. It sounds like brute force has worked fine for them, just, I guess, pushing forward and grinding out their opponent, just winning by attrition, I guess. Whereas Aquanim doesn't really need to worry about this. And in all honesty, Aquanim, if they lose, I'm pretty sure we'll move on. I mean, it might come down to a tiebreaker, but I'm fairly certain that there's only a couple of the players with 3-1 rankings right now. So if Orphelius wins, they're 4-1. If Aquanim loses, Aquanim is also 4-1. And if Google Frog wins, they're also 4-1. And that's a... Oh, and Snugglebase has potential to be 4-1. And North Chilean G actually is 2-1 with a bye. So, no, there is no potential. Winning this match is still important. Like, this isn't a shoo-in. It's not like Aquanim or Orphelius are basically just set to progress. Even though, admittedly, doing well here does improve seeding, so it helps out in the actual final bracket stage. Even if it was, say, top 8, you still want to do well. But at this point, it's you want to win so you can continue. This may be the end of the line for the loser, depending on how the other matches go. Anyway, Orphelius right now getting a lot of raiders up. I guess this is what they mean by brute force. Just attack on all sides. Orphelius just now getting a conjurer. Their commander doing most of their economy construction, while Aquanim, on the other hand, they've had at least one convict. They had that one convict. That's the only one. But they've had it already moving out to expand more, and the commander to the center. So right now, Orphelius really relying on harassment, and this harassment over to the north is going to be effective if they go for it. Getting a bit distracted by the south, apparently. Not sure where are they looking at. Oh, they're definitely distracted by the south. Okay. And now checking out the north. Now getting that glaive over there, and that glaive will help out. Or the glaives, I should say, glaives plural, will be able to get rid of this, and that will justify, to an extent, Orphelius's investment in raiders rather than in economy. But unfortunately, some defense is coming in here. Bandits coming in, although only one bandit against three glaives. The glaives will win. And the big prize is getting rid of this convict, and the convict is going to go down. That's slowing down Aquanim's further expansion and re-expansion attempts. No further convicts are currently in production, so Aquanim right now way behind. Orphelius at the same time, though, not building any more cloaky bots, but they are expanding. They are getting metal. But yeah, get some stuff going. Orphelius, however, they're focusing on their commander, getting the commander up, trying to punch the center through. Wow. Plasma Artillery with Riot Cannon. I actually don't see that very often. I mean, Riot Cannon, yeah, but using the Plasma Artillery on the commander, that's a little less frequent. That's a little less common. I mean, Dynamic Commander System makes it so that it's actually viable, which is great. I'm glad to see it. It's a new thing. I guess it's the crab weapon. And Orphelius back to producing stuff here because they actually need to produce even more. They need a Caretaker to stop accessing right now. They do have the commander building up, though, and the commander... Riot Cannon, otherwise no module, just upgrading for health. Just Riot Cannon and Plasma Artillery, that's it. Orphelius does have to be careful about excess, but at the moment, Aquanim way behind in metal. Now, Aquanim did mention they did win their last match behind in metal, but at this point, Aquanim doesn't even have territory. Orphelius very rapidly able to take this, and Aquanim, what are they planning to turn this around? They have bandits set up, they have racketeers set up, which makes sense to stop the commander, obviously. So my guess is, racketeer the commander, then swarm with bandits and take it out. And dirtbags too. Okay, so that I see what Aquanim is doing. It's definitely what they're doing. Using the dirtbags as well to just tank everything. To tank the defenders, tank the commander. Orphelius, however, with a lot of glaives and a lot of really nice raiding going on here. I mean, there's just 6-1 advantage, so there's really no micro required. Just attack. But Orphelius' commander now having to deal with the dirtbags and the bandits and... of course, the racketeer. But the problem being that Orphelius' commander was not disarmed. That assault there by Aquanim a bit too early, a bit too fast. Now the commander finally been disarmed, but unfortunately, that's not going to make a difference. The glaive's already here to help defend, and they're going to hit the racketeer. Really, that's going to be it. If the racketeer goes down, Aquanim's going to have no recourse. Another one is under production and just about done. But that racketeer getting killed, or just a... is it going to get killed? It's pretty likely to get killed. One glaive still alive. No, just barely get saved. Wow, I was sure that racketeer is going to die. I was absolutely certain those glaives are going to take it out. Very nice there by Aquanim, just pulling back from the eastern side. Their harassment force basically being used on defense, but at the same time, Aquanim able to take the flank. So this is actually working out exactly the way I thought, with Orphelius taking the center, really trying to punch through that, and Aquanim taking the flanks and being clever. Because judging by how they were talking about their matches earlier, this fits brute force versus come from behind cleverness. Now, Orphelius, on the other hand, they have a bunch of reclaim. And they are taking that reclaim. They have this reclaim as well. It's 200 metal. And they have more metal they can build as well. But it looks like we have some ticks going on here. Ophelia switching over to defense. They're switching over to a bit of an assault force as well. We already saw the commander, obviously. But now with warriors on top of that, getting an assault riot force to... looks like just punch through. Not really trying to play the raid counter raid game anymore. And Aquanim now getting a metal advantage over Ophelia's with excess. And unfortunately, a conjurer right there too. Another conjurer being built up. But, and this one in the main base not being used to assist the factory. Why is that not happening? That needs to happen. That conjurer is pretty much dead weight right now. And Orphelius is gonna start falling behind as a result. I mean, the defender construction, that's gonna help. That'll reduce some of the problem. That'll, a bit, sort of. I mean, they have 20 metal, they have their factory going, they have the commander going, but any reclaim is going to be excess. And now, finally getting a caretaker up, realizing, oh wait, I've got to be building stuff! I'm accessing metal! So Aquanim now taking the metal advantage, having taken the southeast, and Orphelius just now taking the northwest. They were taking it before, but they stopped. And this main base also getting attacked. Pretty hard too. This bandit should be able to get rid of a few metal, or no, one metal extractor, one wind gen. I was gonna say a few wind generators, but no. Got distracted by the glaives. And at the same time, Orphelius is forced over to the southeast, stopping Aquanim from taking this for free, because really that was kind of ridiculous. But did Orphelius know about that? Or they just, no, they just checked. They just went and looked. They don't have radar coverage of that area. So right now, Aquanim is not in a safe position. And Orphelia is able to just run around the sides. Aquanim also running around the sides, though, taking that... sorry, Orphelia running around the sides. Aquanim doing a bit of harassment over to the northwest. But once again, Orphelia is in a bit of a tricky spot. And the roach... oh, well, there's a roach there? That did not do any damage. But yeah, the commander... it can't be hit too hard. That's the problem. Or the commander gets hit by the racketeers, it's done. And Orphelius has still invested a lot in that commander. So there is still a great deal of worry. While, on the other hand, Aquanim just setting this up. I mean, they have... sorry, Orphelius setting up all his energy. Aquanim looks like they're trying to still set up their comeback. They have the gunships, though. The gunship switch has been finalized. I probably should have pointed that out. But there is a gunship now. Some Banshee, a Banshee, needs more. And Orphelius' commander probably going to get stunned out, and then the Banshee follow-up? Bandit follow-up? Any follow-up? There's the bandit follow-up. Okay. Orphelius' commander. How much health did it have? Not enough. 3,000, 2,000, 1,000, and dead! Killing off most of Aquanim's forces, but at least Orphelius does not have that frontline assault that they had before. Orphelius still in the game. They are nowhere near out of this. Getting a lot of raiding going on, but not able to just push with impunity is the problem. That was the problem. They could just have really waltzed in there, other than the racketeer, there was not much stopping them. But Aquanim, nicely done there with a racketeer. That's exactly what they needed. Setting that up, and warrior versus banshee, surprisingly, thanks to the warrior not really fighting the banshee, going in the warrior's favor, sorry, going in the banshee's favor. Normally it's the warrior's favor. That's generally the recommended course of action against banshees is warriors, and there's a good reason for that. They do hit the banshees quite accurately. They're very effective. It's just that they have to actually shoot at the banshee, which that particular warrior was not. So much for that. But Orphelius, unfortunately, they're not taking, they have to retake these. They have so many metal extractors they could retake. They have the caretaker in the main base. They have a bunch of conjurers too. They can get this metal to actually work for them, but they aren't rebuilding. They're starting to rebuild now. One of these, where is it? Which one is rebuilding? Because there's something that's apparently rebuilding. The factory. Oh, no. What is doing the rebuild here? Oh, I see. The hacksaw is being built up. And then those two conjurers are going to go forward and rebuild. That's still really slow, though. That might... if it weren't for the fact that Orphelius has an overwhelming territory advantage, that would sink the game. I think that would be the thing that would get Orphelius out of the game. And at this point... Aquanim can't really punish for that. Aquanim is kind of on the ropes. I mean, fair amount of damage being dealt by the brawler, at least some suppressive pressure. If they get rid of the Stardust, that should help a lot. And then following that, it's just a matter of getting rid of the rest of this stuff. But Aquanim, that's all they've got. They have the Banshees as well, raiding around a bit. That helps. But Orphelius with those hacksaws, just to make sure the Banshees cannot run around with impunity. No easy way to get rid of the Brawler, though, but otherwise, this is not being a problem. It's just Orphelius can't win as quickly as they'd like. But Aquanim still kind of iffy, still doing some damage, which is good for them. That's what they want. What's the range of the hacksaw anyway? Okay, the hacksaw does sort of cover the metal extractors, not super well. This is still going hard for Aurelius. Sorry, for Aquanim. I'm getting confused. Aquanim over to the northeast. I really wish this would keep the colors sorted, but I thought it did. I thought it was supposed to be the order based on, like, whoever was further to the left or further to the right. That would help a lot. I thought that was the case. Apparently not. Whatever. Anyway, the point is, Aquanim is sort of, kind of, trying to push this back, but the economy is not working out for them. Orphelia is now getting those metal extractors back, which will help a lot. I mean, they should have had that a little bit earlier, but that's, like I said, not a big deal. Not something Aquanim can easily punish them for. The thing Aquanim can punish them for is the fact that there's so much reliance on these heavy units, which racketeers just chew up. And there's not much that can be done about that for Orphelius other than switching over to glaives, which then get chewed up by defenses. Although, maybe brawlers. Like, not really much actually is chewing them up, so glaives are a good choice. I'm a bit surprised we aren't seeing a scythe just go back, or a scythe or two, just go back to get rid of the racketeer, but that would be really risky. Like, it would be one of those things where it would work really well if it worked, but it would fail really hard if it failed. So I can see kind of why that's not being done, but at the same time, it would work really well if it worked. That's just me, though. I tend to be a bit weird like that. And the Banshee getting a bit too close to that warrior for his own safety. But Aquanim able to take the center, sort of. The fact that the commander's not there helps a lot because it means there's no easily defended constructors on the front lines. So Aquanim can, over time, wear away at this defensive line, which Orphelius had built up, but the commander not being there means there's no easy way to keep rebuilding it. There's nothing that's able to survive long enough. And Roach over to the southeast. Kind of missed that, but we do at least see it did enough damage to stop Aquanim from losing the southeast without a fight. Actually, overall, they didn't lose the southeast either. Oh, that was the relevant Roach. Oops. But yeah, at this point, it is essentially just a matter of attrition. Orphelius, they've lost their defensive line. Aquanim able to rebuild, able to reclaim, getting the economy back up. While at the same time, Orphelius trying to just dissuade all these air attacks as best as they can. That's the real thing. Just make sure the air cannot do anything with impunity. And at this point, I'd say that Orphelius is doing a fine job. Aquanim's still able to defend, and now that they've retaken, or at least opened up, the two metal extractors in front of their base, we should probably see a slight increase in economy for Aquanim. At this point, Aquanim is reclaiming their way to parity, or slight advantage. But of course, there's also the military aspect of it, which Orphelius, despite the fact that they are going for forces able to be countered by racketeers, does probably have enough glaives that there's the support there as needed. That's really what it's going to come down to, I think, is the combined arms and the fact that basically, while the bandits are going to get ripped apart by warriors, which will then be stunned up by racketeers, the glaives aren't going to be stunned out by racketeers, and are probably in big enough numbers that the bandits can't really stop them yet. Whereas I'm a bit surprised that Aquanim has not started taking these metal extractors. I'm not totally surprised, reclaim being generally higher priority, but I'm still a little bit surprised. Especially given that Orphelius is just gradually chipping away at all of Aquanim's flank wins. Although, nice raid, never mind, Aquanim actually is going for some raiding. They are taking some of Orphelius's metal extractors away from Orphelius. Not taking many of their own, but still at least making sure Orphelius' economy is not able to grow for free. That's always the important thing. Make sure your opponent has to work for it. Unfortunately, they did give away the bandits. Aquanim basically donating loads of metal for a reclaim, which not as effective, I'm afraid. Yeah, 300 metal there. Half of that being Aquanim's. Sorry, half of it being Orphelius's, half of it being Aquanim's. So that's 150 metal that was donated. Not ideal. That's three glaives or so. Like, the glaives that died in that fight are basically paid for by the reclaim in that fight. And Orphelius with the counterattack, but no easy way to get in. The bandits aren't really a threat. The brawler being a threat, and the outlaws being also a massive threat. An Octodem just oversized, just taking care of small wins, small skirmishes here and there, raids around the sides, throwing brawlers in where there's no anti-air, throwing bandits in where there are anti-air emplacements just to make sure that they can go away. Although, those cobras, wow, that's a lot of health. Still, that does help. But Gremlins up as well to get rid of the brawlers. That's a good choice. Gremlins don't do well against Banshees, but we don't see any Banshees up. I bring that up because there was a recent game with Gremlins versus Banshees on Acklan Wastelands, which is not relevant because those are brawlers, and Gremlins do actually dissuade them from attacking. Still, yeah, Aquanim able to do a lot of harassment, get some damage done, but Orphilius already having the army advantage despite the economic disadvantage that they currently have. Orphilius able to get... Are they going to get rid of the gunship plant? I kind of doubt it. The brawlers are providing too much resistance. And that roach putting the nail in the coffin. Okay, so that glaive is all going back. At least there aren't the caretakers moving in, but Aquanim does not really have the economy to push both factories with caretakers at this point. With reclaim, yes. That does prevent Aquanim from benefiting a huge amount from massive reclaim. Doesn't allow them to build up as much in the gunship factory. But in both cases, we're kind of seeing the players have enough of an army that they can lose their economy, and it's not going to affect them immediately. They still have to win or lose fights in order to get out of it. One brawler down, though, and another brawler probably about to go down, too. Aquanim's forces getting rid of the gremlins, but not quickly enough. Those gremlins are kind of doomed, scattering behind enemy lines. No, not scattering, actually grouping up. They are cloaked, but one of them is giving away the position of the rest of them. At this point, Orphilius basically gave away all that. The one that wasn't cloaked should have gone in a different direction because that would have made it seem less obvious. But Aquanim able to take out three for free when only one of them should have died. Very tough call though, but yeah, it was one of those things where the whole group moving away and one of them being cloaked meant the entire group was basically revealed. So Orphilius losing, that's about 1,000 metal worth of gremlins at this point. That's a sad loss. That is a sad day for gremlinkind. It'll be remembered in infamy. As all the gremlins died horribly for very little good reason. Now, oh, Orphilius throwing the towel? Really? Well, I guess they figure Aquanim took the territory and now Orphilius throwing it in. Aquanim taking that hard fought match. Real comeback, although I think Orphilius might have had a bit of a chance, but I guess they figured Aquanim was coming back, taking the center, and Orphilius, having lost their early game metal advantage, didn't have much, and Orphilius actually did excess a lot too. That's probably the biggest problem. Orphilius did have a unit value advantage for the first half of the match. Yeah, halfway through, that was when they lost, I think, a bunch of warriors or a bunch of glaives. I'm trying to remember exactly what died there. But yeah, Aquanim just did ultimately win out. But Orphilius, I feel like they kind of had a chance. It's just their excess didn't help. It's small things like that did not help. Also, not having this, I had mentioned before, like not having that, Aquanim didn't punish Orphilius for it, but it would have been a larger army. And that might have done the trick. Especially around here with the glaives. And maybe not, though. The roaches are pretty good at equalizing things, so... Tough call, but yeah. So, Aquanim takes it, and I think... That's... Okay, Snugglebase and Google Frog still finishing up. That's the last one ready. That's gonna be done soon. So yeah, that... Aquanim versus Orphilius is... Oh, still an interesting match. That I am glad I watched that. Very glad to see it. I think it'll depend on the Google Frog and Snugglebase match who proceeds. Although, I'm not really sure. If you look at the standings, Aquanim 5-0, undefeated so far, takes top spot. Icon's actually possibly getting second spot. And Orphilius at 5th, although Snugglebase and Google Frog still fighting it out, so I don't know. It'll be 4-1. It'll be 4-1, 3-2, 3-2, 3-2, 3-2, a lot of 3-2s. We might have a tiebreaker match to determine the 4th spot. It might be Buchholz. We have enough rounds, I think, that Buchholz will actually be able to hold and do its job. But I don't know. Yeah, Aquanim has at least been undefeated. Definitely top spot. Oh, we're still waiting on Snugglebase and Google Frog. This is really tense. I don't know what's going to happen. I don't really want to jump in right before the match ends. But yeah, this is pretty big. But yeah, about the game, let's go back to the game a bit. I just want to talk about this a bit more because I feel like it was a good demonstration of where that brute force thing kind of fails. I mean, we saw with, like, Orphilius went for the assault. And that was clearly what they were trying to do, was punch through the center. And that Racketeer was a good choice, but I feel like Orphilius was relying a bit too much on the commander. I think they were probably not thinking, oh yeah, Racketeers are going to wreck my commander. Because the commander moved forward when it died, and I don't think that quite lost Orphilius the match, but it definitely contributed, just because that meant the front line could go down, which meant Aquanim could rebuild and regroup and have territory, and Orphilius couldn't continue pressuring it. I'm a bit surprised we didn't see a bunch of glaives go forward to try to wreck up the Racketeers and then push forward with the commander. But clearly we had the warriors up, which were trying to also help the assault. But I'm a bit surprised we didn't see like five or six glaives just push forward, try to kill the Racketeer, snipe it out, and then the commander goes in to finish the job. I feel like that would have done a lot of damage and would probably turn the game around. But really, it just came down to Aquanim hiding this quite well. They got that up, got that set up. Orphilius had no clue. And then the commander dying, which, good choice in the Racketeers, and Orphilius kind of pushed forward with it a bit too far. But yeah, Aquanim was basically just waiting for the opportunity of when is that commander going to come forward? And once it did, that was a lot of Orphilius's metal. And then, of course, that was also the frontline defenses, which Orphilius did not supplement with warriors combined, warriors or glaives or whatever, combined with conjurers. It was just left to get slowly whittled down. But that really did end it. I feel like Loving Lands is a pretty good map, though, for this sort of thing. Like, I feel like Iced Coffee might be a little bit too small or clunky. Avalanche, same thing. But Living Lands seems to be a bit more suitable just because you have that outside side that Aquanim was able to take advantage of, but Orphilius couldn't easily deal with. Sort of could, but not as easily as Orphilius took the center. But then Aquanim couldn't quite cut through the center as easily. Still, I really liked Aquanim pushing in with the small raids just all around. That was cool. Like, clearly, just trying to inch their way back in after Orphilius' very strong start. Slowly but surely did take it out. But yeah, so that was definitely a match where the commander mattered a lot. Anyway, I think that's about all I can really say about it. Orphilius had the metal advantage, Orphilius had the metal excess. Like, metal advantage by produced, metal disadvantage by used. Man, that production stuff. There was a few times where Orphilius had no production in the Cloakybot factory. I'm kind of surprised at that. Not totally. They are at the yellow level where they have a lot of situations they know of where it's not necessarily ideal to do that, and they want to optimize for frontline stuff. But it's really important when you do that to then go back and make sure you aren't accessing. That's super important. At any rate, it looks like we are going to be seeing probably Aquanim, Icon, Snugglebase, Google Frog, or maybe Aquanim, Icon, Snugglebase, Google Frog, Winner, and Orphilius. That seems likely. Still waiting. It's going to be at most another... Oh, it's done. Alright, who took the last match? Who took Snugglebase and Google Frog? It was Snugglebase! So the final standings are Aquanim, Snugglebase, Icons, and Google Frog. Wow, Icons did get passed. And, oh, Orphilius and Icons. Tied for book holds, but not for tiebreaker points. Apparently, against tied opponents, Eichens won more matches, which is, I suppose, technically true? Orphilius and Eichens never went up against each other. And it's, yeah, that's what it's down to from the looks of it. It's like tiebreaker, and then between that, Orphilius beats Vel'Thos because Orphilius beat Vel'Thos. Otherwise, it's the tiebreaker, like, number match against all these 3-2 players. Everyone who has 3-2, all five of them. Eichens won three matches among them, I guess? Number match wins against tied opponents. So Eichens, Google Frog, Orphilius, Vel'Thos, Don. Eichens did beat Don. Eichens beat Don. Eichens lost to Snugglebase. Eichens beat Crudor, which doesn't really matter anymore. Eichens beat North Chilean G, who is technically tied by points. So Eichens beat Don, North Chilean G. Who else did Eichens beat, though? Google Frog. No, Google Frog lost. Google Frog beat Eichens. What the heck? That is weird. Why does it count that against as a tiebreaker win? How is that a tiebreaker win? They lost to Google Frog. Google Frog, that's one of their two tiebreaker wins. Not sure how this is being done, honestly. Well, apparently, small issue. Honestly, I'm kind of surprised that Buchholz isn't being used first, then tiebreaker. A little bit of a weird thing, I think. Because the Buchholz thing is basically the all the players' opponents' scores with top and bottom dropped, which means Orphilius would actually be tied with Eichens, come to think of it. Huh, I guess Eichens is still winning that. I guess part of it is that Eichens was against Crudor, who ended up resigning, which doesn't help. And that's also the lowest score, which is being dropped. Whereas Orphilius won against Vel'Thos and Snugglebase, but that's the top score, so yeah. Or not Snugglebase, sorry, they won against, who did they win against? Markeeves, oh, they did win against Snugglebase, that's right, yeah. Oh well, Shenlong apparently being really odd about how Swiss works. Anyway, we're gonna, I think, have a break between and then move on to elimination bracket. Because I'm pretty sure we're just top four elimination. So, Aquanim, Snugglebase, Eichens, Google Frog, probably. Although, as I'm pointing out, it's disputed, so we'll see how that goes. I don't know how this is gonna be handled because, like, the thing is, within the tournament, it's not super clear. Because Eichens got apparently weaker enemies, and Orphilius got stronger enemies because there was no seeding, which means that, actually, which kind of surprises me, too, because that would kind of make sense. I mean, randomized makes sense for a pure elimination for the way we're doing it, for double elimination, because it means that everyone gets a shot. But in Swiss, everyone gets a shot. That's how Swiss works by default. So I could see there being good argument for seeded Swiss, that way you don't have these weird issues where players are playing opponents of wildly different strengths, and then you end up with this dispute at the end. But yeah, it looks like Eichens and Orphilius is kind of disputed. I think both Eichens and Orphilius want Orphilius to play, rather than Eichens to play. That's the impression I'm getting right now. But I don't know what's going to happen. It's up to Swordtail. Who also just point out, thank you for organizing the tournament, Swordtail. That's really nice of you. I realized there were some organization problems before, and I was a bit harsh about that. Although, if you're watching on YouTube, you probably didn't see it, because I don't want to put stuff that's unprofessional up on YouTube. So, yeah, that's a missing thing. But thanks anyway. Oops. Thank you, Swordtail, for organizing this. Obviously, some kinks, but those are no longer relevant since we are at the elimination stage, which admittedly still has a bit of a kink. I almost wonder if it would be better just to have top eight, but top eight would probably end up... I mean, top eight's much less disputed because that's where the current cutoff is for score. But, I don't know, it was also really like 12 or 13 participants. 15 at first, but now 13, and top eight would be a bit tricky. Alright, so I wonder if really we should try to go for top. I mean, the problem is that the tournaments aren't huge. If they were larger, obviously top eight for elimination would make more sense because then we'd have no disputes or fewer disputes. There'd probably still be disputes at the top eight level in a lot of cases, but fewer disputes. But yeah, top four is super small. That, or you could have, like, top six, and then have Ophelius and Felda start in the loser's bracket. Or something. Or actually, you could just have the top four starts in winners, bottom four, like, five through eight starts in losers. And then maybe that would work. It wouldn't be any that much longer, but it would at least prevent this problem. But then the problem is also that you have other... Why does Dancer have four buys? Okay, Dancer and Crudor have buys they shouldn't have. I think that's probably the problem for ranking right now. Is that they don't have buys. They're gone. They're out of the tournament. They shouldn't count at all. I don't know why they're here. That actually explains a lot, come to think of it. That's... bug, I think. Although, on the other hand, neither Ophelius nor Icons played Dancer, so I have no idea. Like, Dancer was playing against Phaltos here. That's about it. But otherwise, yeah, they played Snuggle Base. Oops. But otherwise, nothing. Alright, so it looks like we're having Icons and Orphelia switch. I don't know, we'll see about it. Anyway, we're going to go on a bit of a break in between. So, once I get back, we'll have it worked out. Or they'll work it out, I guess. Until then, stay tuned. It'll probably be about 15 minutes or so. I'm going to guess. So, be back in a few minutes, or 15, or probably 10, 15 minutes, I'm guessing.